how do we fix the brain after it's been injured, whether it be by any of these diseases? And that really starts to get us to the next stage, is that not only do we need to know what causes the problem, we need to understand the brain well enough so that we can essentially get the replacement parts once it's been broken. And so that enters kind of this idea of what's called a brain-computer interface. Basically, if we can translate the machinery of your thoughts, if we can understand those signals, we can then access those and use those for all sorts of things to basically allow your thoughts to communicate via machine to control anything from a cursor on a screen to your own limbs. And that one can imagine that you can then be able to, for instance, if somebody has a spinal cord injury, has had a stroke, to allow them to recover function by using essentially a human-computer interface.
I see. So the brain-computer interface has two parts. It's really decoding your brain signal and then using machines to transmit that signal to a machine that can move.
That's exactly right. Or do a number of things, whatever suits your intentions. And so here's an example of one of our subjects who had electrodes placed on the surface of his brain to treat his epilepsy. And hopefully you can see that cursor, but he's using imagined movements as if he was to move a cursor to basically get to those different targets using thoughts alone. Now, he was really fun to work with because he got bored. He said, can I play some video games? And so here you can see he's moving his hand, and we're decoding those motor movements from the electrodes in his brain. And he's controlling this cannon here. And you're going to see that the Space Invaders are coming over, and pretty soon he's going to start moving it around. And he actually does a really, really, really good job of controlling that cannon to shoot all those Space Invaders. As it turns out, he's got, and there's not a lot of people in this pool, so I'll just qualify that. He's in the Guinness Book of World Records for having the highest score in a video game using his brain to control the video game.
So amazing.
now, this is an electrode placed over Broca's area. You folks have all learned about that tonight. Here we're decoding whether the person's imagining saying ooh or ah, and they can control the cursor going to the left or to the right. And again, this is, we're starting to get access to the things that, in my opinion, make us very human, our imagined thoughts of speaking to ourselves.
So, this is all great, but people's skulls are open. Do I need to crack my skull open, have wires coming out to do
this? Well, actually, you don't. We've actually designed, we can use this, and we can actually try to do it non-invasively these days. Now we're going to put Albert to the test. And to see if he can actually,
let's see.
What it's actually doing is it's measuring, it's a named kind of brainwave called Fadeaways associated with attention. And basically, when you are paying attention to very certain things, such as counting backwards or doing what's called serial linguistics, meaning, get it up. See, when he concentrates on that, that he can basically move his brain up to the top of the screen. And if he starts to relax, then he can start to let it drop down. And then, but he better not relax too much or else he's going to get hit by a plane. Oh! give Albert a big round of applause.
So, that makes me think about what might come in the future. And what if people like Eric here have really cracked or decoded the neural code? What kind of a future might that bring?
Well, imagine a world where basically the world around you is as accessible as an iPad. And again, we can imagine things where you could modulate your environment with your thoughts alone, you can communicate with your thoughts alone, or if you've got some type of deficit or injury, that you can basically have a device that can restore that function. One thing that we've got going on right now is we actually have a clinical trial for stroke rehabilitation, that basically somebody with a paralyzed hand can put on a headset, and not too long after, they can basically have an orthotic that opens and closes their hand soon after training. And as we get really good with this, that one can even imagine truly replacement parts. This is one of the first implants for spinal cord injury patient controlling a robotic arm. And you're going to see that this is the first time he gets to touch his wife in 3 years after sustaining his injury.